hnrcdocs@mail.house.gov. That's hnrcdocs@mail.house.gov. Additionally, please note that as with in-person meetings, members are responsible for their own microphones. As with our in-person meetings, members can be muted by staff only to avoid inadvertent background noise. And finally, members or witnesses experiencing technical problems should inform committee staff immediately. And I will now begin with my opening statement. I want to begin by thanking our impressive list of witnesses for being here today, including the delegate from the U.S. Virgin Islands, Congresswoman Stacey Plaskett, and Lieutenant Governor Ale from American Samoa. I would also like to welcome the Vice Speaker of the Guam Legislature, the Honorable Tina Munya Barnes, and distinguished academics, Dr. Daniel Immerbar, Dr. Peter Watson, and for the former Marianas resident, Professor Rose, who is on Villazor. Lastly, welcome to Mr. Neil Ware, former staff of the U.S. House of Representatives and now president of Equally American. Today's witnesses will be discussing H.R.S. 279, which would place the U.S. House of Representatives on record as rejecting the racist reasoning of the insular cases. These cases are a series of Supreme Court decisions concerning the constitutional rights of residents of the overseas territories the U.S. acquired in the Treaty of Paris in 1898, namely Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippines. But the insular cases have also been used to determine rights in the United States Virgin Islands, American Samoa, and the Northern Mariana Islands right up to the present day. The explicit reasoning behind the most famous of the cases, Downs v. Bidwell in 1901, was that the new territories are inhabited by alien races that could not be governed by Anglo-Saxon principles. Ever since, the insular cases have been used to block territorial efforts for equal treatment in essential federal programs, Medicaid and food stamps to SSI, the Supplemental Security Agency. It is true that the Territorial Clause, Article 4, Section 3 of the U.S. Constitution, which gives Congress the power to make all needful rules respecting the territory or other property of the United States, provided a judicial basis for the insular cases. But the theory that some territories are incorporated into the United States and therefore the Constitution applies there in full, while other territories are unincorporated without the full protection of the Constitution, was an invention of the United States Supreme Court. The territorial incorporation doctrine was based on the same racial views and stereotypes that led to the notorious Plessy v. Ferguson decision in 1896 that gave us the separate but equal doctrine, separate but unequal doctrine, and segregation, I will say. Plessy v. Ferguson has, of course, been overturned in the modern era. The insular cases, however, relics of the racist views of the 19th century, which has no place in our nation today, are still in active use by the courts. H.R.S. 279 puts the House on record in favor of overturning the insular cases. We recognize, however, that this must be done in a manner that respects the uniqueness of each territory. In American Samoa, for instance, we must take care to craft a solution that allows the U.S. nationals to be treated as U.S. citizens under some federal laws while preserving the local Maatai culture. In the Marianas, my home district, the courts used the insular cases to justify the seeming incompatibility of the equal protection guarantee of the 14th Amendment with the restrictions on land ownership only to persons of Northern Marianas descent, set forth in Article 12 of the NMI Constitution. This is a 33-year-old decision which may sit on shaky ground, given more recent rulings on racial classifications and the conservative bent of today's judiciary. I look forward to what our witnesses have to say about the wisdom of relying on the insular cases to protect Article 12. But let us not think that the Territorial Clause prohibits Congress from extending the applicability of programs such as SNAP, TANF, Medicaid, or SSI to the territories. because they, in one way or another, are already up to some of the territories. Congressional will or lack thereof is what denies these programs to the territories. Again, thank you all for being with us today. I look forward to receiving your testimony. The chair now recognizes the vice-ranking minority member for Insular Affairs for her opening statement, the resident commissioner, Gonzalez Colon. Please, you have 3 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The Constitutional Territorial Clause gives Congress full power over the governing and fate of the territories and their residents. After the Spanish-American War, a major debate arose regarding the fate of the newly acquired territories and the status and constitutional rights of the residents of those territories. The debates reached the Supreme Court in a series of cases later called the Insular Cases, where it held that full constitutional protection of rights does not automatically extend to all places under American control. This meant that inhabitants of unincorporated territories, such as Puerto Rico, even if they are U.S. citizens, may lack some constitutional rights. As Judge Juan Torruella explained, the Insular Cases authorized the colonial regime created by Congress, which allowed the United States to continue its administration and exploitation of the territories acquired from Spain after the Spanish-American War, and allow for the United States government to extend unilateral power over these newly acquired territories. Former Puerto Rico Supreme Court Chief Justice José Díaz Monge contended that the Insular Cases were based on premises that will be legally and politically unacceptable in the 21st century. Premises such as that democracy and colonialism are fully compatible, that there is nothing wrong when a democracy such as the United States engage in the business of governing other subjects that have not participated in their democratic election process, that the people are not created equal, some races being superior than others, and that is the burden of the superior people, the white man's burden, to bring up others in their image, except to the extent that the nation which possesses them should in due time determine. These decisions were odious, reflecting cultural and racial biases that are now rightfully rejected by most Americans. I co-sponsor this resolution being discussed today because the Insular Cases doctrine denies democracy and equality and reflects abhorrent bias and have provided a justification for Congress to discriminate against American citizens unfairly and irrationally, citizens to whom full representation in the national government has been denied. Some of the language of the resolution, however, may confuse the fundamental issue of the territory's status. And I want just to make clear and make the record clear as to where I stand. It is not the Insular Cases that deny the residents of the territory's voting representation. Articles 1 and 2 of the Constitution do. It is not the Insular Cases that have denied equality in federal programs. It has been Congress who has done that. As to the Puerto Rico political status, the policy of the federal government's political branches has been that is the sole responsibility of the majority of the voters of Puerto Rico to determine its ultimate political status from among the possible constitutional status, statehood or independence, with or without a subsequent sovereign relationship with the United States. And public law 114-187, for example, recognized Puerto Rico's right to determine its future political status. The island has had three free and fair votes on possible status options in 8 years. The first in 2012 specifically rejected the current territorial status, while in the last plebiscite in November last year, the majority of voters choose statehood. The solution chosen by voters in Puerto Rico to determine its ultimate political status is clear. They choose to be clear majority of equality within the nation that their citizens are of. The voters of Puerto Rico understand that equality can't be taken away, and equal voting representation can only come through statehood. In 1957, the Supreme Court stated that neither the Insular Cases nor their reasoning should be given any further expansion. However, The court has not overruled these decisions and continued to cite them as precedent. In 1944, the Supreme Court validated the practice of forcibly relocating U.S. citizens to concentration camps on the sole basis of race as within the scope of presidential authority. And it took 75 years to the Supreme Court to correct that. And that's the reason today we can have an opportunity to overcome that. And however, this resolution will send an unequivocal message to the executive branch and to the judiciary branches of our government that we repudiate the cultural biases that the cases are based on, and as such, should not be basis for their decisions. Having said that, I just want to put on the record the book of Chief Judge Gustavo Helpi, that it's been nominated today by the President of the United States to be a judge in the Boston Circuit, and it's the constitutional evolution of Puerto Rico and the U.S. territories. I think this is an obligated lecture for the committee. Thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you. Resident Commissioner Gonzalez Colon. I will now turn to our witnesses, but before introducing them, I will remind the non-administration witnesses that they are encouraged to participate in the witness diversity survey created by the Congressional Office of Diversity and Inclusion. Witnesses may refer to their hearing invitation materials for further information. Now I will introduce our witnesses. On panel one, we would have the Honorable Stacy E. Plaskett, the delegate from the United States Virgin Islands. Panel two, we'll have our invited witnesses, Dr. Daniel Imerwar, Professor, Department of History, Northeastern University. Mr. Newwear, President Equally American, the Honorable Tina Munya Barnes, Vice Speaker of the Guam Legislature, Professor Rose Quizon Villador, Professor of Law and Chancellor's Social Justice Scholar, Rutgers University. Dr. Peter S. Watson, President and CEO of the Dried Group and former White House Director of Asian Affairs, National Security Council. And I'm gonna try this, I apologize, but the Honorable Taloega Eliasalo Ba'alele Ale, Lieutenant Governor of American Samoa.
Great job.
I hope I got that right. Let me remind the witnesses that under our committee rules, they must limit their oral statements to 5 minutes, but that their entire statement will appear in the hearing record. When you begin, the timer will begin and it will turn orange when you have 1 minute remaining. I recommend that members and witnesses use stage view so they can pin the timer on their screen. And as we're told, we have two timers today that will alternate in within by 2 or 2:30. After your testimony is complete, please remember to mute yourself to avoid any inadvertent background noise. I will also allow the entire panel to testify before the questioning of the witnesses. So the chair now introduces, let me see the order I have. The Honorable Stacy Plaskett, the member from the U.S. Virgin Islands. Ms. Plaskett, you have 5 minutes, please.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Ranking Member Westerman, and members of the committee, as well as the distinguished guests. My name is Stacy Plaskett. I represent the Virgin Islands of the United States in the U.S. House of Representatives. I want to really thank you for holding this hearing on House Resolution 279, which would condemn the insular cases. This is a historic hearing indeed. More than 3.5 million United States citizens are denied constitutional rights simply because they reside in one of the five U.S. territories: American Samoa, Guam, the Northern Mariana Islands, Puerto Rico, and the Virgin Islands of the United States. The combined populations of the territories is greater than that of 22 states and that of the five smallest states combined. It is a central principle of our American democracy that Americans, through their votes, can have a say in their government. And yet millions of Americans have almost no say in federal decision-making, even when it directly affects the islands they live on. At the core of the disenfranchisement of territorial residents are the racially charged series of Supreme Court decisions in the early 1900s, the Insular Cases. Prior to the Insular Cases, territories were viewed as inchoate states, areas on the path to full statehood. However, with the Insular Cases, the Supreme Court invented an unprecedented category of unincorporated territories not on the path to statehood and whose residents could be denied the most basic constitutional rights. Those decisions were explicitly informed by racial assumptions, with residents of the territories, as you have heard, described as fierce, savage, restless people who were absolutely unfit, quote unquote, to be citizens as they could not comprehend American Anglo-Saxon principles. The irony that the Supreme Court in the 1900s stated that Virgin Islanders, such as Dean Hamilton Jackson, a journalist, Edward Wilmot Blyden, the founder of Pan-Africanism, Herbert Hubert Harrison, one of the founders of the Negro Renaissance in Harlem, Camille Pissarro, the founder of Impressionism, Alexander Hamilton, cannot understand Anglo-Saxon principles or indeed the Constitution, the irony is profound. It comes as no surprise that one of the most influential of these cases, Downs versus Bidwell, was decided by the same justices who invented the separate but equal doctrine of racial segregation in Plessy v. Ferguson just 3 years earlier. But the legal basis established by Plessy was reversed in Brown versus Board of Education in 1954, as the court recognized that the nation could not operate in a supposed separate but equal category, which in reality was separate and unequal. While the discriminatory precedent set by the Insular Cases continues to affect 3.5 million Americans, the Supreme Court has yet to revisit this precedent. Furthermore, the past three administrations, Trump, before that the Obama administration, before that the Bush administration, have reaffirmed this position. I call upon the Biden administration to chart a new course, reject the Supreme Court decisions in the Insular Cases, and recognize the importance of supporting equal rights of Americans living in the territories. The ramifications of the Insular Cases extend to all aspects of life of U.S. citizens in the territory. Residents are denied access to crucial federal support, despite paying more in federal taxes collectively than several states. While in recent cases of United States versus Madero, the U.S. Department of Justice has disclaimed the Insular Cases limit to the application of equal protection in the territories, it nonetheless still continues to embrace the flawed logic that the Constitution applies only in part in so-called unincorporated territories. Ultimately, the ongoing discrimination against Americans in territories in federal benefits program cannot be separated from the harmful legacy of the Insular Cases. This is seen in major disasters in the COVID pandemic. The territories are extremely vulnerable. The Insular Cases set the precedent and created a near permanent colonial status. Prior to the Insular Cases, under the Northwest Ordinance and other doctrines, territories were given support, economic, population growth incentives to eventually become states. For us living in territories, that does not happen. The Supreme Court has left the question of the Insular Cases unanswered. Amicus briefs have been filed by elected leaders. This is a bipartisan request for dismantling the cases. It was even argued in the Supreme Court by Republican-appointed Solicitor General Paul Clement and Ted Olson. This is why the House must take up and pass House Resolution 279 and send an official message that the Supreme Court's decision in the Insular Cases are contrary to the text and history of the Constitution.
Thank you, Ms.
From racial views, I thank you to the committee, and I thank you for allowing me to be a co-sponsor of this resolution. And as a resident of the Virgin Islands, it is of utmost importance that we, as members of Congress, confront our disenfranchisement. Thank you so much, sir, for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I now would like to recognize Dr. Daniel Imawar for 5 minutes, please.
Great. Distinguished committee members, it's a pleasure to be here. I'm come to you as a historian of the United States and of U.S. foreign relations. I teach at Northwestern University, and I've written a book about the history of the United States' relations with its overseas territory. As I gather you've heard already, the territories that we're talking about, the unincorporated territories, came to the United States as a result of a dramatic moment in U.S. history, a war with Spain in which the United States annexed the Philippines, Puerto Rico, and Guam from Spain and took the non-Spanish lands of Hawaii and American Samoa at the same time. Suddenly, the people in these territories accounted for 10% of the U.S. population, and this prompted a set of political debates about what was, you know, should they be citizens, should these new lands be states? And I think what's really important to recognize is that that political debate was rooted in racism. For a sort of representative sense of this, a senator from North Dakota objected that if Hawaii were considered as a state, it would ultimately be represented by a government of quote-unquote dusky ex-cannibals. There were two dominant positions, one an anti-imperialist position, which is to say that the United States, in order to hang on to its tradition of representative government, would have to jettison the territories. The assumption underlying that was that it was unthinkable that the people from the territories could actually be in Congress making laws. The other position, the imperialist position, was that the United States should retain the territories and jettison representative government in the territories. And that's exactly what happened. The imperialists won. The territories were taken and held, but they were taken and held not in the way that former territories had been, but forthrightly and explicitly as colonies where colonial rule was imposed and statehood blocked. The insular cases are an important artifact from that political moment. What they did, in essence, was to carve out room within the U.S. political fabric for colonies. As you've heard, they divided the territories into incorporated and unincorporated territories. This was a novel legal doctrine, and the bulk of the population was in the unincorporated category. And then the court ruled that the Constitution didn't fully apply to the unincorporated territories. As one justice explained it, the Constitution, yes, is the supreme law of the land, but the unincorporated territories are not part of the land. These legal decisions, not just the political culture around them, were suffused with racial ideals that strike us as abhorrent now. There are references in the insular cases to territorial inhabitants as savages and as quote-unquote alien races. One justice objected that to include them within the constitutional fold would quote-unquote wreck our institutions, perhaps leaving the whole structure of government to be overthrown. Others have already mentioned, and I think it's really important to grasp, that the justices who decided this case were by and large the justices who also decided Plessy versus Ferguson. And that's not entirely an accident. Those two decisions, the insular cases and Plessy, have a lot in common. What Plessy did was to divide the country into distinct administrative spaces for whites and for non-whites. And what the insular cases did was to divide the country into a constitutional zone and into an extra constitutional zone, or at least a zone where the Constitution didn't fully apply. The difference, of course, is that in 1954, the Supreme Court overturned Plessy versus Ferguson, and now we look back on it as one of the court's great mistakes, something that warped the Constitution and deprived millions of their rights. The difference, of course, is that we have not yet repeated the insular cases. They are still cited, and I think it's beyond time that we do that. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much, Professor. At this time, I'd like to recognize the Lieutenant Governor Ale from American Samoa, please. Sir, you have 5 minutes.
Good afternoon, Chairman, Ranking Member, members of Congress, the committee. On behalf of Governor Manumaumau and myself, I bring greetings from the people and government of American Samoa. Talofa, talofa lava. And thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today to share our strong opposition to the proposed insular cases resolution, House Resolution 279. This measure, while well-intended and perhaps justified in certain circumstances, is in our view a blunt instrument that will only hasten the destruction of unique cultures within the U.S. territories and insular areas and it will destroy the right of the people of American Samoa to democratic self-determination. Currently, the people of American Samoa have a degree of self-determination and a voice and a way of protecting our culture and way of life. This arrangement preserves our traditional Samoan way of life, or Fa Samoa, including communal land ownership, cultural traditions like prayer curfews, and that most of our island's land should stay in the hands of persons with Samoan ancestry. American Samoa has been a U.S. territory since 1900. However, we are not U.S. citizens, but rather non-citizens, U.S. nationals. We cannot vote or run for office in the incorporated U.S. or hold certain government positions. But there is a unique difference between American Samoa and other U.S. territories. Natives of Guam, Commonwealth of Northern Marianas, Puerto Rico, and the Virgin Islands. We are not, as I said, citizens. And we like the decision on whether we become citizens to be decided not by a court, but by the people of American Samoa and its elected leaders. In December of 2019, a district court judge all the way out in Utah made that decision for American Samoa. He decided that American Samoans should be birthright citizens of the U.S., done without no involvement whatsoever by the local people of American Samoa or its elected leaders. Now, ending the application of the insular cases as proposed in this resolution, as I said earlier, may well be the right thing to do with other territories. All of these other territories have taken the step to democratic self-determination and have decided their future. American Samoa has not. American Samoa still has to make that decision. And eliminating, wiping out the infrastructure, the structure prepared in the insular cases on how the Constitution should be applied to U.S. territories is will destroy the right of American Samoan people to take that important step and decide for itself democratically whether it wants to be U.S. citizens or not. Our voice and our message has always been clear. We want our political status and our rights under territorial law to be decided by our people, our elected leaders, local, federal. We do not want to have court decide the fate of our people, as it was done, resulting in the insular cases. Congress has the right to do so, and we ask that Congress address the ailments that are affecting other territories, making them want to destroy and wipe out the insular cases. Now, let me be clear. We support the intent of the resolution to repudiate the racist and shameful attitudes depicted in the insular cases. However, we believe that to completely wipe it out is incorrect. These cases have been condemned by courts, have been condemned by Congress, but to completely eliminate, as I said earlier, is a blunt instrument. The people of American Samoa are proud to be part of the United States government and are proud of our heritage of supporting the U.S. military and being part of the U.S. family. However, we believe a core principle of our unity, of our relationship, is the protection of the rights of people to decide democratically how they want to live. Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to be here and to testify on this important resolution. And I would submit for the record letters from Governor Limbaugh and myself to our counterparts regarding these issues. Thank you very much. So forth.
Without objection, so ordered. And I now like to recognize the Honorable Tina Munya Barnes, Vice Speaker of the Guam Legislature. Ms. Barnes, you have 5 minutes.
Half a day. My name is Tina Rose Munya Barnes, and I am the Vice Speaker of the 36th Guam Legislature. My committee recently held a public hearing on Resolution 56-36, a measure I introduced in support of House Resolution 279. My testimony today is, in part, based on the testimony presented before my committee. I would like to begin by expressing thank you and undunklu nasizuas masi to Chairman Grijalva and Vice Chairman Gregorio Kilili Sablon for authoring House Resolution 279. Today, I will be discussing the injustices of the insular cases on the people of Guam and our sister territories. I ask that my full written testimony, as well as the Guam Legislature Committee report on Resolution 56-36, be entered into the record.
So
thank you. My grandfather is the late Colonel Juan Munya, for whom the Guam National Guard's headquarters bears his name to honor his contributions to the United States Armed Forces during World War II. I am also the proud wife of an Air Force veteran, the mother of an Air Guardsman, mother-in-law of an Air Guard veteran, and a grandmother-in-law of a deployed Army soldier, a level of patriotism and service shared by many on Guam. As a daughter of Guam, I am grateful that this conversation is moving forward, but frustrated that this has taken so long. While this resolution sends a strong message, Congress can do more. It always could. Its plenary powers allow Congress to tailor-make a binding political status process unique to each territory. You all have made notable strides by temporarily raising our Medicaid allotments and increasing the federal Medicaid rates through the fiscal year 2020 appropriations and the Family First Coronavirus Relief Act, but they are temporary measures set to expire. While I am also grateful for the numerous relief packages passed by this body and the continued advocacy of Guam's delegate, Congressman Mike Sinicolas, I echo Governor Lourdes Leongaro's sentiment that this high match requirement has prevented us from availing of much needed federal funds. The unequal treatment of the territories has also prevented American citizens from availing of federal programs they otherwise would have access to if they lived in a state. To challenge this unfair policy, Ms. Katrina Schaller of Guam filed a lawsuit in the District Court of Guam in December of 2018. Katrina and her twin sister, Leslie, both lived with myotonic dystrophy, which severely inhibits muscle function and other critical aspects of daily life. Leslie is able to live independently in Pennsylvania due to the aid she receives from SSI. Katrina, however, is ineligible for the same benefits by virtue of her geographic location. Attorney Rodney Jacob, who serves as Katrina's counsel, testified, "It is contrary to common sense, human decency, and sound public policy to deny public benefits to all other American citizens with disabilities living on Guam. As a result of this injustice, and at the request of my good colleague, Senator Mary Camacho Torres, I amended my resolution to seek parity on this matter. Senator Torres and I may hail from different political parties, but for the benefit of our people, we can work together. I hope you all share the same desire." To be clear, I echo testimony submitted by Attorney Julian Uggan that the rejection of the insular cases must be carefully approached and cannot be America's justification for its relationship with the territories. We must also acknowledge our right to self-determination. In closing, I come before you today as an island leader, a proud American, and a daughter of Guam, on behalf of Guam's people and their contributions to this nation. What I ask for is simple, and yet it has been the long struggle of this great nation. I ask that every American be equally American wherever we might live, and that each of us be given the chance to manifest our own destiny. On behalf of the people of Guam, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sanamasi.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Vice Speaker. I now recognize Mr. Neil Ware for 5 minutes. Mr. Ware, please.
Thank you for the opportunity to testify today, this historic first ever congressional hearing focused on the insert cases, and I appreciate those who have joined from the territories despite the challenging time zones. I'm Neil Ware, president and founder of Equally American, the only nonprofit whose mission is to advance equality and the right to vote in U.S. territories. I've also recently taught legal seminars on the law of U.S. territories at Yale Law School and Columbia Law School, and a published scholarship on the insert cases in the Yale Law Journal and Harvard Law Review. Equally American approaches our work through a civil rights lens and does not take a position on political status in the territories, other than to support self-determination and decolonization. Through our impact litigation, we work to build the kind of broad awareness and consensus at both a national and local level needed to end the second-class treatment of U.S. citizens in the territories. I speak today on behalf of Equally American, not on behalf of any clients we represent. Simply put, America has a colonies problem. And the reason is clear. A series of racist early 1900s Supreme Court decisions known as the Insler cases. As a consequence of the Insler cases, 3.5 million residents of U.S. territories are treated as second-class citizens, and sometimes even denied citizenship itself. From a civil rights perspective, the U.S. continues to deny residents of the territories the right to vote for president and voting representation in Congress, even as Congress maintains the power to govern the territories unilaterally. From a human rights perspective, the U.S. has fallen far short of its commitments to self-determination, decolonization, and indigenous rights. At the same time, citizens in the territories have higher military service rates than any state and contribute billions of dollars in federal taxes every year, all while being denied equal participation in a broad range of federal programs that other citizens simply take for granted. In short, the insert cases have laid the groundwork for what Judge Jose Cabranes has called, quote, colonialism as constitutional doctrine. Or as former Guam Congressman Dr. Robert Underwood recently said, the insert cases, quote, encoded into the political DNA of the United States of America that colonies are okay. The insert cases have been criticized by both liberal and conservative legal scholars alike, with prominent originalist scholar Michael Ramsey recently explaining that, quote, the Insler cases are an abomination, something originalists and non-originalists should be able to agree on. While the Supreme Court has acted to overrule many of its appalling decisions, like Plessy versus Ferguson, the Insler cases remain not just on the books, but they continue to cause real harm. As Guam Attorney General Levin Camacho recently said about the Insler cases, the harm is not hypothetical. Indeed, their legacy has meant a denial of SSI benefits, a lack of parity in Medicaid, veterans discrimination, all without a vote or say in federal law. Nor would overruling the Insler cases serve to impede self-determination or decolonization or result in the parade of horribles some of the witnesses today warn of. If anything, turning the page on the Insler cases is necessary if we are to have serious conversations about these issues. Last year, the Supreme Court questioned the continued validity of the Insler cases, indicating the Insler cases should not be further extended. Yet this has not stopped the Insler cases from continuing to be relied on by the U.S. in court filings. In Fidisimano versus U.S., DOJ has relied on the Insler cases to argue that, unlike everywhere else on U.S. soil, there is no constitutional right to U.S. citizenship for people born in so-called unincorporated territories. In another recent case, U.S. v. Baxter, DOJ relied on the Insler cases to limit the Fourth Amendment's protections against unreasonable search and seizure in certain territories. And of course, in U.S. v. Bayo Madero, recently taken up by the Supreme Court, the denial of SSI benefits is a clear legacy of the colonial framework established by the Insler cases. If history teaches us anything, simply waiting for the Supreme Court to reverse an injustice is not enough. That's why I commend the bipartisan co-sponsors of this of HRES 279, who call on the Insler cases to be rejected in their entirety. And I also applaud the work of this committee to address many of the inequalities residents of the territories face through statutory means. The U.S. DOJ should also take a moment to reflect on its continued reliance on the Insler cases and cases involving the Constitution's application to residents of U.S. territories. I'll take it as a good sign that the Biden-Harris administration announced today it's nominating Chief Judge Gustavo Helpe, a strong critic of the Insler cases, to fill the vacancy left by the passing of Judge Juan Torrella, whose legacy fighting against the Inser cases is an inspiration to all of us. The people of the United States must ask ourselves, who are we and who do we want to be? Do we as a nation accept or reject the colonial framework established by the Inser cases? And what does that call upon us to do? Condemning the Inser cases is an important start, if only a start. A century of colonialism as constitutional doctrine is enough. I ask that you support this resolution and look forward to your questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Weir, right on time. I now recognize, let me see, Professor Rose, who is on Villazor. Please, you have 5 minutes, Professor.
Good afternoon, distinguished Chair Congressman Sablon and distinguished members and witnesses. My name is Rose Cruz Quizon Villazor. I am Vice Dean and Professor of Law at Rutgers Law School in New Jersey. Thank you for the opportunity to provide oral testimony on the Inser cases. I request that my written testimony be entered into the record. As you may know, I am a legal scholar whose work has focused on immigration, citizenship, critical race theory, Asian Americans, Pacific Islanders, and the law. I have written articles on the Inser cases that have been published in the Harvard Law Review and California Law Review. I have included links to those articles in my submitted written testimony. On a personal level, I was born in the Philippines and grew up on the island of Saipan in the Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana Islands. I therefore also have a personal connection to issues that involve people in the U.S. territories. Today, I offer my qualified support for House Resolution 279. There are three reasons why my support is qualified. First, I support denouncing the Inser cases for their racist origins and racial subordination of people in the U.S. territories that rendered millions of people second-class citizens. Second, I recognize that the Inser cases have led to unequal application of U.S. constitutional principles in the U.S. territories, and that unequal application of the U.S. Constitution has ongoing harms today. Having said the above, allow me to explain my third point, which addresses why my support for House Resolution 279 is qualified. Despite the racist origins of the Inser cases, it is important to recognize that these cases may be seen in a different light when viewed from the perspective of individuals who negotiated the political agreement known as a covenant that established the Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana Islands in political union with the United States. In particular, the covenant provided that because of the importance of the ownership of land for the culture and traditions of the people of the Northern Mariana Islands, and in order to protect them against exploitation and to promote their economic advancement and self-sufficiency, only persons of Northern Marianas descent may own permanent and long-term interests in real property in the CNMI. As originally written, Article 12 of the CNMI Constitution defined persons of Northern Marianas descent as a U.S. citizen or U.S. national who has at least one quarter of Northern Marianas Chamorro or Northern Marianas Carolinian blood. Article 12 has since been amended so that now persons of Northern Marianas descent refers to a U.S. citizen or U.S. national who has at least some degree of Northern Marianas Chamorro or Northern Marianas Carolinian blood. Notably, because Article 12 restricts land ownership in the CNMI based on bloodline, it would no doubt be categorized as a racial classification and thereby open to being challenged under the 14th Amendment's Equal Protection Clause. Under conventional equal protection analysis, race-based laws are subjected, and rightly so, to the most rigorous and exacting constitutional standard of strict scrutiny, which provides that for the law to survive, it must have a compelling government interest and that the means employed is narrowly tailored to achieve that compelling government interest. Crucially, laws that are viewed as racially discriminatory are generally struck down. Article 12 faced such an equal protection challenge in the 1980s and 90s, but survived. In Wobble versus Villacruces, the U.S. Court of Appeals of the Ninth Circuit chose not to use traditional equal protection analysis, but instead relied on the Inser cases to uphold Article 12's constitutionality. It should be noted that when it was then challenged, Article 12 had the narrower and arguably non-racial version of Article 12. As I've explained in my articles, if Article 12 were challenged today, a court would most likely use equal protection analysis instead of relying on the insular cases, and it would likely strike it down because it is race-based. The most recent Supreme Court case that would support this conclusion is Rice versus Cayetano, in which a Supreme Court struck down a blood quantum preference for Native Hawaiians as violative of the 15th Amendment. My goal for today was to simply prompt a discussion on the limits of equal protection analysis and my concern that the law is ill-equipped to address the unique laws that are designed to promote the political and cultural rights of the people of Northern Marianas descent. Thank you very much for the opportunity to offer my testimony today.
Thank you. One of the best time kept so far. And now, finally, Dr. Peter Watson. Dr. Watson, you have 5 minutes, please.
For the...
Dr. Watson.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity of being here today, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. By way of background, I was actually born, like others, not in the United States. I'm a first-generation immigrant here. My background is from a working-class immigrant community in New Zealand, where I first came to appreciate the sensitivities of immigrants from all around the world, which led me to representation of peoples before, for example, the United Nations Trusteeship Council, where I appeared twice before the decolonization and self-determination hearings in the 80s and on behalf of the Pacific Islands Association. Therefore, my frame of reference, as you might imagine, is first and foremostly the protection and advancement of the most deep and sovereign rights of self-determination. That is obviously at core, at least what I perceive we're seeking to do today, taking into consideration, as we all can and should do, the racist and abhorrent language that was used in many cases, not just in the insular cases, but I'm going to reference others that actually cite the insular cases. So at core today, what we are doing is to urge protection, firstly and foremostly, to the self-determination and rights of sovereign-owned peoples whose rights are freely given to them not by the government, but by God, and indeed, of course, the rights are not granted to them by government at all. And accordingly, further to my written statement, I'd like to just reference some observations that I have on the resolution as written. And what is immediately evident to even non-lawyers is when you look at the resolution, there's no offered definition of what's considered to be insular cases. People think they know what that means, but jurists indeed cite from 6 up to 16 rulings of the United States Supreme Court in that line of decisions. And accordingly, the use of the term insular cases in resolving Clause 4 of the resolution has no effective juridical meaning. The resolution naturally, therefore, is a nullity without identifying the specific laws of each ruling that it seeks to, in fact, overturn or to nullify, how that each element they seek to do so is unconstitutional. And that clearly is the only way that courts can subsequently discern which way or which or the rationale for how it is that the Congress determined, which was indeed unconstitutional law, bad law, or indeed good law remaining. Actually, limiting the resolution's Part 4 purge to jurisprudence of the insular cases, if you could do it, which I've just referenced, it's very difficult, raises the really problematic question of how to treat other cases which reference or cite the insular cases. which includes the Fitzamano case, where, as we know, the court and plaintiff lawyers rely on the 1880 case of U.S. Wap Kim Ark, which cites the Dred Scott case and favorably quotes the court's own racist epithets directed at Mexicans and Chinese in the earlier slaughterhouse cases. So if Wong Kim Ark is not purged from Fitzmanu case, then Resolution 279 will only be selectively anti-racist. Now, under House Resolution 279, as proposed, there is material doubt about how the courts will play the role of judicial review assigned by the Constitution if both sides of the argument on the insular cases that have been relied upon by Congress and the courts for 120 years cannot be openly and fully deliberated in pending and future litigation on application of the Constitution in the territories. And of gravest concern, House Resolution 279, in fact, could be interpreted as an invitation for the courts to repeal the insular cases without giving any rights to sovereign people exercising their self-determination. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Watson. And I want to thank all the witnesses for their testimony. Next, we will go to questions. Committee Rule 3D imposes a 5-minute limit on questions. So the chair will now recognize members for any questions that they may wish to ask. I am going to start with my questions. In my opening statement, I said I am concerned that Wabo v. De La Cruz's, in which the Ninth Circuit used the insular cases to uphold Article 12 of the Commonwealth of the Northern Mariana's Constitution and the restriction of land ownership to persons of Northern Mariana's descent, might have a completely different outcome today, 30 years later. In that time, the federal court has said Northern Mariana's descent is a race-based classification, and not Supreme Court Justice Brett Kavanaugh co-wrote an amicus brief challenging race-based voting in Rice v. Cayetano. So anyone who wants to protect Article 12 should be thinking of alternative legal theories or even new law to support exclusive NMD land ownership to protect culture and tradition, because the insular cases may not help. As a matter of fact, Commonwealth and federal courts have held as legal fee simple ownership of land claims made by individuals who are neither domiciled in the Northern Marianas in 1950, nor were they ever citizens of the territory of the Pacific Islands. So, Professor Villazor, some quick yes or no questions, please. In Wabo, the Ninth Circuit said the equal protection guaranteed to all U.S. citizens by the 14th Amendment did not apply to the Northern Marianas in the case of old property ownership, correct?
Yes.
The Wabo decision rested on the conclusion that some aspects of the 14th Amendment are not, quote, fundamental in the international sense, correct?
Yes.
And this idea that some constitutional protections are fundamental and others can be taken away by act of Congress derives from Balzac v. Puerto Rico, one of the insular cases, correct?
That's correct.
To determine whether property ownership was a fundamental right, the Wabo court applied the standard used in King v. Morton. Quote, the importance of the constitutional right at stake makes it essential that a decision rest on a solid understanding of the present conditions in the territory. It must be based on facts. You pointed out in your 2018 law review article that present conditions in the Marianas are that a significant portion of land is no longer in native lands, but rather leased or occupied for decades by non-indigenous groups, correct?
Yes.
So a court today might look at this change pattern and conclude that permanent control of land is no longer fundamental to the people of the Marianas, correct?
It might.
Professor, there can be exemptions from the equal protections of the U.S. Constitution if there are compelling public interests, correct?
If there are compelling government interests, that's correct.
and public is the government. So I say yes. In Wabo, the court found a public interest in protecting land ownership because land is the basis of family organization in the islands, passes from generation to generation, contributing to the well-being of family members, correct?
Yes.
Yet in 1985, the term of land leases was extended from 40 years to 55 years, so that conceivably two generations of Northern Mariana citizens would derive no direct benefit from family land or have any say in how that land is used, correct?
Yes.
And in 1990, when the Wabo Court decided that equal protection did not apply, only persons of at least one quarter Chamorro or Kalinyan could own land, correct?
Yes.
Yet in 2014, the Constitution was amended so that a person with any Chamorro or Kalinyan blood could own land. So instead of requiring a Chamorro or Kalinyan grandparent, now you only need a great, 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 and on and on and on grandparent. The Wabo Court noted that the looser the fit, the more likely the asserted interest is mere pretext. The fit between who is NMD and who is not has become very, very loose since Wabo was decided, has it not?
That is correct.
And that loose fit weakens the argument there is a compelling public interest in exempting Article 12 from the equal protection of the 14th Amendment, correct?
That will be correct under both the insular cases and equal protection law.
Thank you. As I said, I'm not here to take sides on the question of Article 12. This is an issue for the people of the Marianas to debate and decide. What I do want to establish, however, is there are reasons to think that if a court today were to look at whether the equal protection of the 14th Amendment applies in the case of Article 12, the conclusion might be very different than it was 30 years ago in Wabo. And if anyone is holding on to these racist insular cases as a way of keeping Article 12 afloat, they may be holding on to an anchor, not a life preserver, because the next time around, the insular cases may not protect Article 12. Thank you. Let me see. I need to now recognize Ms. Gonzalez-Colon. You have 5 minutes. I hope I didn't exceed my time. Did I exceed my time?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, 5 minutes.
I will thank you and the witnesses for being with us today. And my first question will be to Dr. Watson. First of all, thank you for coming. I think your experience as a former White House Director for Asian Affairs and National Security Council provides some ideas of how the government always deal with the insular cases. Dr. Watson, the resolution we're considering today rejects the insular cases and their use in present and future cases involving the application of the Constitution in the U.S. territories. If this resolution passed, it would not overturn the insular cases, but it will establish that the House of Representatives rejects their treatment as precedent by the executive branch and the courts. However, wouldn't you say that Congress already have the power and the authority to override the inequities perpetrated by the insular cases under its Article 1 authority?
No, I wouldn't say that, actually. In the event that Congress is seeking to do, well, at least there's two powers that, and just by way of background, ma'am, while I did spend some time at the National Security Council for several years, I served in a quasi-judicial capacity at the congressionally mandated and established International Trade Commission, which indeed had its decisions upheld or not by the United States Supreme Court. So I've had some opportunity to look at the relationship between Congress.
Can you answer the question, sir?
No, the question is that Congress can overturn those elements that are not constitutional and are administrative in nature. If they wish to overturn matters that are constitutionally based, you have to do so likely in Article 9.
But Congress has authority to do that, right?
That involves, by the way, a By definition here, what I'm referring to is a constitutional amendment man.
Yes,
they do.
That's the answer I was expecting. You can discuss previous examples of cases in which the court refused to overturn precedent of case law that was discriminatory. But Congress always stepped in to address and correct those inequities. Can we say that the Ledbetter case can be one of them, that Congress actually acted on that precedent of the courts and then acted directly to amend the law?
Ma'am, with respect, I was here before the committee to reference the interest of those exercising self-determination. I'm not a constitutional expert on particular applications, and I would not presume to.
Thank you, Mr. Watson. Then I have questions to Mr. Neil Ware, president of Equally American. You recently co-authored an article in which you pointed out that at least since the 1950s, the Supreme Court has expressed skepticism of the Insular Cases territorial incorporation doctrine and has said courts should not extend it further. In that essay, you pointed out that in the Aurelius case, the court continued its decades-long trend of narrowing the reach of insular cases while still coming up short of overruling them altogether. Can you discuss why, in your opinion, it is critical that the court take an extra step and finally overrule the insular cases, or you understand that Congress should act first?
Yeah, overruling the insular cases is important for residents of the territories, just like overruling Plessy versus Ferguson was important for African Americans and the civil rights movement. Just as you can't really imagine the Civil Rights Acts of the 1960s or the Voting Rights Acts without Plessy being overruled, many of these policy changes, which Congresswoman Gonzalez correctly noted, Congress does currently have the power to address statutorily. But so long as this constitutional framework of inequality is in existence, it really takes away a lot of the pressure for Congress or the White House to act on these issues. So overruling the insular cases is an important step, but it's just the first step to move forward on the range of issues that you've been working to address in your role as the representative of Puerto Rico.
Thank you. My time expired. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Yeah, thank you. Jennifer, we could go back for another round if you so wish. Ms. Wagon of American Samoa, please, you have 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Sablon and Ranking Member Gonzalez-Colon, for holding this hearing today, and thank you to the panel for your testimony. I find myself unable to fully support 8 Res 279 because I believe wholesale rejection of the insular cases may have unforeseen or undesirable implications on the future relationship between the territories and the United States. I also do not feel personally comfortable signing on to a resolution that makes judgments on what precedents another independent branch of government can and cannot base their decisions on. However, I still want to express my sincere appreciation for the intent behind the chairman's resolution and my sincere gratitude for his efforts on behalf of the territories. It is undeniable that the cases contain outdated and racially biased language. Such language can be harmful, and I'm sure we'll all agree that we have a responsibility to distance ourselves from such outdated views, as well as a responsibility to do right by the people of the territories. In my opinion, rather than make moral judgments on the decisions of another branch of government, it would be prudent to use our powers as a legislative body to address the issues of the territories directly. Congress has better tools than a House resolution to make things right. And we have a responsibility to act rather than do things indirectly through the other branches of government. This is the most effective way to actively distance ourselves from the racist rhetoric of the past while making real and substantial changes. I also want to emphasize that we act in Congress line with the will of the governed. The residents of the territories each have their own opinions about their relationship with the mainland and their future, and express that to Congress. The D.C. Court of Appeals, in the case of Tuaua versus United States and the American Samoan government, protected against what many in American Samoa, including the territorial government itself, consider to be an imposition of citizenship by judicial fiat. We simply cannot ignore the basic truth that the supermajority of people actually living in American Samoa vociferously opposed the case and the relief that it sought, and continue to oppose the forum shopping going on in the Fikisemanu case. One may disagree with racist tones underlying the insular cases, but do not abandon the wishes of the residents of American Samoa in the process. Finally, I want to point out that American Samoa is unique by virtue that it became the only United States territory by deeds of cession starting in 1900. The Matai, or local chiefs of Tutuila, the largest island in American Samoa, voluntarily ceded the island to the United States in 1904, and Manu'a followed in 1900, and Manu'a followed in 1904. Lieutenant Governor Talawenga Talofa, in the hearing materials and testimony submitted today, there are references to a pending decision in the 10th Circuit Court of Appeals on a Utah district court as to whether or not American Samoans born in the territory should have birthright citizenship. While we anxiously await the outcome of this case, could you elaborate on what the D.C. Appeals Court held, that it was anomalous to impose citizenship over the objections of the American Samoa people themselves, as expressed through their democratically elected representatives?
Thank you, Ufatali, Congresswoman. That was the decision in the Tuaua case. The D.C. Circuit held, applying the framework of the insular cases, that the decision on whether or not the Constitution applies has to be decided from the viewpoint of the governed. So from the viewpoint of the people of American Samoa, in this case, whether or not this application of citizenship is practical and or anomalous to the culture of American Samoa. The evidence presented in that case led the court to conclude that applying the citizenship clause to American Samoa is both impractical and anomalous, and therefore it wasn't applied. And so that's the short answer to the question.
Mr. Chairman, before I yield, I would like to ask unanimous consent to enter into the record an article from the Guam Bar Brief and a statement on H. Res. 279, both written by Dr. William B. Cleary, a professor of law at Hiroshima Shudo University and former Assistant Attorney General for the Territory of Guam. Mr. Chairman, yield back.
So ordered. Thank you. Let me see. I must say, Mr. Gomart, are you still on? Mr. Gomart, one, going once, going twice. Let me see. Please bear with me. Let me see. Mr. Tiffany, going once, going twice. Mr. Oberdahl, you've been patient, sir. You have 5 minutes.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And thank you to our witnesses for a very interesting hearing here. I have a question for Dr. Watson. I realize that we're not here to debate legal terms, but I have a question regarding the intention of H. Res. 279. Do you think that, I mean, obviously this would be signaling Congress's objection to the insular case rulings to the court system in the hopes that they would revisit that, right? So do you think that the term insular cases as used in H. Res. 279 is clear and concisely understood enough to put the courts on notice about which court cases are bad law that Congress wants to be purged, and which cases are still good law?
Absolutely not. There is no clarity from the resolution as drafted as to what's intended by that term. And as I mentioned in my testimony, even the judiciary has extended the interpretation of this up to at least 12 cases. And this does not include, as I mentioned, cases that cite the insular cases. It would be unconstitutionally vague and would invite excessive judicial participation against congressional action. With your permission, sir, may I just provide a little finesse to my earlier response to Ms. Gonzalez, please, with your permission?
That's fine.
Ms. Gonzalez, I actually need to state with a little more clarity that Congress, obviously, using its existing authority under Article 5, Article 1 and Article 5, can, in fact, deal with statutory refinements within its existing constitutional authority.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Weiss.
Thank you, sir.
A follow-up question for Mr. Ware, if I could. I found your testimony very interesting, and you've stated the necessity of changing the constitutional framework of the insular cases. And I'm wondering what you would recommend that we as a society do about that and how to go about it, because obviously this resolution doesn't accomplish that. So what is the path that you would recommend?
Thank you for that question. As a matter of constitutional doctrine, the examination of constitutional issues in the territories could look like is really what it looked like for the more than a century prior to the insular cases and the doctrine of territorial incorporation being invented. And continuing forward, the relationship between the federal government and the District of Columbia also provides a framework for constitutional interpretation in non-state areas. Beyond that, though, it's important, one of the important consequences of the insular cases was creating this view that it's okay for the United States to essentially have colonies and not do anything about it. And that's why places like Puerto Rico and Guam have now been part of the United States for more than 123 years. That's more than half as long as our country's had a constitution. Having the Congress, the Supreme Court, and the executive branch condemn the insular cases, condemn the colonial framework that they established is an important step towards engaging the political branches and engaging the people of each of the territories in a serious conversation about what their future relationship with the United States is. So this is just a first step, but it's an important one in creating, disrupting a status quo that has existed now for too long and fully bringing to the table all of the different parties that have equities and stakes in these issues.
Okay, so I understand that the resolution is a first step, but the next steps would be what? A Supreme Court decision overruling and changing the ruling of the insular cases, a constitutional amendment initiated by Congress and ratified by the states? I mean, both of those?
Yeah, I think having the Supreme Court review and overrule the insular cases would be a strong step forward in turning the page on the insular cases in this colonial framework. In terms of the political branches engaging in a serious process of self-determination and decolonization, whether for some areas that meant a path to statehood, whether for others that meant independence, or perhaps a constitutional amendment to address some of these issues. But really, until there's this pressure on the political branches to act, what we've seen over the last decades is either a lack of will or an unwillingness to engage with these really challenging questions. And because residents of the territories don't have voting rights, as the delegates and resident commissioner on this committee know all too well, there needs to be pressure and support from others who do in order to bring the Congress together, bring this country together to move past what is really a regrettable chapter in American history that's gone on far too long.
Well, thank you very much. It's an important topic. I'm glad we're having the discussion. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd now like to recognize Ms. Porter. Are you still on, Katie? Ms. Porter? Ms. Porter going once? why Ms. Porter is not with us. Let me see, Mr. Benz, please.
Sir,
you have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you for this most interesting hearing, and thanks to all the witnesses for taking the time to testify today. And I want to yield my time to Congresswoman Gonzalez-Colon. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for yielding. I do have a question, Mr. Chair, to the Honorable Tina Rose Munya, the Vice Speaker of Guam, if you're available. Vice Speaker, in your testimony, you correctly pointed out that the resolution we are considering today will be non-binding on the courts. And I agree with you on that. And it will not override things or cases. Can you discuss why it is crucial that Congress go beyond just denouncing the insular cases and use its constitutional power, including its plenary powers over the territories, to address the inequities we face? And I know that you discussed unequal treatment under Medicaid and the inability to access SSI programs as just some examples of inequities that Congress should address. And I agree with you that Congress can make this different, just allowing territories to access and have full citizenship in terms of erasing the inequities. So again, can you address the inequities we face?
Thank you so very much for that question, Congresswoman. As I mentioned in my testimony, my resolution states that denouncing the insular cases as racist is the first step, but it is my hope that this means that we now can urge Congress to use its plenary powers and begin binding a political status reconciliation process, one where I believe each territory is brought to the table as we chart our path forward. And again, in short, that would be my answer. And I could further detail this, especially with all the committee testimonies that were done at our public hearing last week and submitted into the record. I hope that, that this would further answer your inquiry today. And I want to just say thank you for that question.
You know, that recognizing the cultural and racial bias underlying the insular cases in 1956, the court began stating that neither the cases nor the reasoning should be given any further expansion. And it has not, however, reversed the decisions and continues to cite them, consistent with previous holding, as reversal would mean. All of the current territories will be considered eventual state, and the Constitution empowered Congress to determine statehood, or the territories will have to pay taxes under the uniformity clause, and so on. So my question now for you will be, some contend that the insular cases are the reason that the current territories can be treated worse than a state in federal programs. But didn't the Supreme Court say in Harris versus Rosario that Congress, which is empowered under the territory clause of the Constitution to make all needful rules, regulations respecting the territory belonging to the United States, may treat territories differently from states so long there is a rational basis for his action? Yes, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And as I support the closer relationship with the United States, like statehood, I believe in my heart that everybody needs to come to the table and make that decision.
I agree with you on that. And so a reversal of the insular cases doctrine that some territories can be possessions instead of part of the U.S., unincorporated, will not amend the territory clause power of each Congress to treat territories as it wishes in federal programs. Even if equal treatment is extended to a territory, it can be withdrawn. And as was done in the case of Puerto Rico for food stamps, aren't the only ways, you know, to guarantee that treatment lie in the hands of Congress?
I agree that every territory is unique and that they should be able to to share their story. And that's why I truly believe that Congress does have this plenary power to begin this political status reconciliation process. And as we tell each story with each territory and see how we can chart this path moving forward. So again, each territory is unique and different from the other.
I agree with you, and I agree that Congress should act, and then the court will follow. I yield back my time has expired.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Mr. Lowenthal, sir, you have 5 minutes and you can yield it to me. I wouldn't mind.
Thank you. I'm learning so much, and I am very, Mr. Chair, I thank you for doing it, holding this hearing. And but I'm going to pass on questions. I just really want to learn.
I said you could yield your time to me. I wouldn't mind.
I will yield. I would definitely yield my time to you.
Thank you. So I'm just going to have this question because, look, I fully understand that, you know, there are in the thousands of federal programs that exist in law. There are 700 plus programs that apply to the territories. Either some of them apply to, like SSI, it applies to the Northern Marianas, but SNAP applies to Guam and the U.S. Virgin Islands. I mean, there is, you know, all of this mixture. But let me ask, I guess, the legal minds. Let me start with Mr. Ware. Does the territorial clause prevent Congress from making the different federal programs applicable to the five territories? Does it prohibit Congress to make the laws applicable to the territories?
Congress does have broad powers under the plenary, under its plenary powers in the Territories Clause. Whether they can kind of treat different territories differently really depends on the reason for doing so. And with respect to the SSI program, that's a question currently before the U.S. Supreme Court. The reasons that the federal government has given for that disparate treatment to date have really not been very good, which is why federal judges unanimously have ruled that discrimination unconstitutional in the First Circuit and the Federal District Court.
Right.
But these are complicated constitutional questions.
But it doesn't prevent Congress to pass a law today saying SSI should apply to all the territories.
Oh, no, absolutely, sir. Congress has the power to do that immediately. And I know that there's legislation you've supported that would do that. And I appreciate that.
Professor Villazor, does the territorial clause prevent Congress from passing a law making these federal programs available to all the territories?
No, not at all. Congress has plenary powers over the territories and can exercise its powers in treating all territories equally.
Ms. Barnes, Vice Speaker Barnes, would you say Congress has the plenary power to make all these federal programs apply to the five territories?
Most definitely, Congressman.
And let me see, Mr. Watson, does Congress have the authority, the power to do this?
Absolutely, I concur. Extending Congress can, if they wish to, extend federal contributions, Medicare, Medicaid, SSI, and other federal social safety net programs to the territories, as in the states.
So far we have agreement. Dr. Imar, I'm sorry, your last name, sir. Dr. Imawar, does Congress have the authority to make federal programs apply to the insular areas?
Yes, of course it does.
Thank you. And Lieutenant Governor Ali, does Congress have the authority to do this?
Yes, Your Honor, we believe Congress does. And with respect to the insular cases, Congress also has the right to say provisions of the Constitution apply to which territory that they want, or to all the territories. And what American Samoa is saying, when Congress decides that, it should be done on a one-by-one basis, that each territory would come before Congress like Guam and CNMI and Virgin Islands had done before, and negotiate the terms of that compact. And that's why the danger of eliminating the insular cases now is the one we're opposing at this time. Thank you.
Okay, I am yielding my time. Mr. Tiffany, sir, you have 5 minutes. Welcome.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, did you call on me, Representative Tiffany?
Yes, sir. Yes, I just did. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. You know, trying to juggle a couple things here, and thank you so much for your patience, and thank you for giving me the time here. I have a question to Dr. Watson. In the effort to purge racism from those cases sought to be covered by this resolution 279, should other court rulings likewise be included? Today we're hearing about the Fittis et Mono territorial status case in which the court and plaintiffs rely entirely on the 1888 ruling in the U.S. versus Wong Kim Ark, a landmark case recognizing any person born in a state of the union as a citizen under the 14th Amendment. However, as I understand, in Plessy versus Ferguson, it was decided in 1886, Wong Kim Ark by the same court in 1888, and insular cases in 1901. In Wong Kim Ark, the court upheld the Racist Chinese Exclusion Act, relied on comments by justices in the slaughterhouse cases referring to Mexicans and to Chinese in derogative terms, and even relied not on dictum on the law of Dred Scott case, a Supreme Court ruling far more racist than Plessy. Given the intentions expressed in the resolution, should we include Wong Kim Ark? I hope you're able to follow that. That's a long
question. That's quite clear. The objectives undergirding the resolution to remove legacy judicial racism obviously cannot be adequately achieved if Wong Kim Ark and its ilk are excluded. Any other outcome naturally makes a nonsense of the resolution's most worthy core and justified goal.
No, I disagree, but go ahead.
Yeah, well, thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Watson. That is the only question I had for this. I don't know if you wanted to extend your remarks any further in regards to that. We certainly have time if you choose to.
No, not really. It's rather fundamental. The what you have is, and again, you have a, and not really a unanimity or consensus as to what really constitutes the insular cases as referenced. There's the core ones that were originally set, but some jurists extend that, of course, quite naturally to the cases which adopt it, cite it, or implement it. And of course, the number of cases have in fact implemented the insular cases such that it's natural and it's important that the focus of this hearing and the intention to deal with racially based decisions and those that are extended by the Supreme Court in the insular cases, such as Wong Kim Ark, be excluded. That would be not appropriate.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Watson. And Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Tiffany. I now recognize Mr. Gohmert. Mr. Gohmert, you have 5 minutes.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that. I was thinking about yielding my time to Mr. Lowenthal, but he had said he was still learning, so I'll go ahead and...
You could yield to me, Mr. Gohmert. I will.
Well, thank you. Well, I'm like Mr. Lowenthal. I'm learning, too, and I appreciate all of the witnesses here. And I'm going to ask a question. It may seem a bit strange, but I really am trying to learn. And we've got witnesses from different territories. You know, some of us have been saying for many years that the United States is so unusual because we've, you know, we're not out to be an empire and we're not out to brag that, as the British did, you know, that the sun never sets on the British Empire, that, you know, and we have given so much of our greatest treasure, American blood, so that people in all parts of the world could be free and make their own decisions. And I know at one time there was a feeling in Puerto Rico among some that they wanted to be independent. And from what I'm hearing, it sounds like there's more of a desire than there used to be, perhaps be a state. But I'm wondering about the different territories. You know, the British seemed to be really surprised when there was such a big move in India to be independent, and they didn't really see it coming as they should have. So I, it may seem overly simplistic, but I'm curious, since we've got people from different places, is there a feeling among the different territories that they would want independence? I mean, it doesn't seem like we ought to force anybody to be part of the United States, and because we're not looking for an empire. We're all about trying to be about freedom. So I don't want to be surprised sometime down the road. I would ask any of our witnesses, is there a desire in the area you're representing that would want to be independent from the United States, but we don't want to ever lose our friends, and especially as beautiful as some of your areas are, holy smokes, they're just wonderful places to visit. But is there such a feeling that some of us are not aware of? Anybody?
I speak for American Samoa that, you know, as far as I know, we are, there's no discussion, serious discussion of going that direction. I think some 121 years of being part of the American family has really instilled in all of us that we are Americans and part of the American family. What we are, what we want to do is to be given the opportunity to negotiate in a democratic way, to be provided the opportunity to self-determination on how the people of America stand. And that's why we oppose this resolution and its intended effect, because it empowers courts to make decisions. For example, there is a case going on whether or not people from American Samoa should be citizens by birth. And we oppose it because the decision is made by a judge. We don't necessarily oppose these becoming U.S. citizens, but it's the process. We want that process to be done in a democratic way by the people of American Samoa and its leaders, and not by a judge. So that's the opposition that we have in this case. Thank you.
All right. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair, from the island of Guam, we truly believe that our islands here in the Marianas is beautiful, but for Guam, we also believe that we are crucial and strategically critical to Uncle Sam. And whether or not I personally believe I want a closer relationship with the United States or not, the decision whether to choose to be independent, be a state, or have a free association with the United States, it should be up to our people to decide, and that process should be afforded to us. So That's where I personally stand. And I know that with Congress having these powers to begin this political reconciliation process, I think that this is a way that we can truly chart our path forward for our island of Guam. And that's something that we've been asking for, to acknowledge the right to self-determination.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Seeing that Mr. Gomart has no more time to yield to me, right, I would now recognize Mr. Moore. Sir, you have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman. Appreciate the opportunity. Thank you, experts and guests, for being here. It's important. It's an important discussion, and I'm glad we have the opportunity to talk about these challenges. Dr. Watson, just two hopefully very pretty straightforward questions. To get your statement, can HRS 279 lead to political status resolution for the U.S. territories? And two, is that resolution the best way to address statutory equity and constitutional inequity issues facing the territories?
I think I'd just like to reference a question as to whether or not it has the effect that you've intended, by saying this is, I've heard that it's non-binding today. So that would suggest that it does not have that effect. I'm not, obviously not a parliamentary expert, but could you repeat the second part of the question, please?
Yes, and yeah, thanks for highlighting the non-binding part. That would definitely be something to consider. Is HRS 279 the best way to address the statutory equity and constitutional inequity issues facing the territories?
No, I would say not. What one needs to do in government is to make efficient use of relevant tools and authorities, and do it in a very clear and demonstrable way, using the constitutional rights and authorities that you have. It's clear that, as we've talked about today, constitutionally, Congress has the right, Article 1, Article 5, statutorily to deal with matters, including Social Security and the other places. If there's any uncertainty about that, those are the powers and authorities that should be used. The application, utilization of resolutions which do not have clarity, which are uncertain in their terms, I do not believe is helpful.
Thank you. And would you add any additional context on the concept or on the principles of self-determination and federalism? So just continuing on with some of your statements, would you add any additional context with self-determination, federalism, and how they're related and why they're so important to our insular areas?
You know, it's obviously a very different set of, as we know, political relationship, different treaties at the very beginning, different sovereign nations that have dealt with the United States. But I think at its core, and this is really important from the American Samoan perspective, one size does not fit all in terms of the constitutional structures that deal with application of sovereign self-governing and self-determination. What is critical, however, is to protect and preserve, relative to federalism, the rights of people in these respective territories to exercise those powers in a way that their God-given rights are relative to the federal government. It is not the federal government to tell, in that sense, to override the appropriate exercise of self-determination in the respective territorial environments.
Excellent. Thank you. As we've reflected, and we've had several committee hearings on territories and insular areas, and as I reflected on it, it's very clear to me that there are many similarities, but I would never ever go out to highlight, you know, and make sure to constantly highlight there is distinct interest, and there's varying different. You cannot treat everything the same. This final question will be for Lieutenant Governor Ale. Since the resolution fails to recognize territory self-determination, how do you think it might affect territories that have different interests? How might it be detrimental, if you believe so?
It's detrimental to American Samoa, for example. If this resolution is passed and we move on to a future where the insular cases are removed, then the culture of American Samoa is affected. We have a communal land culture that provides that the land is for the people, native people of American Samoa. That will automatically be a violation of the Equal Protection Clause if all provisions of the Constitution apply to American Samoa by saying that the insular cases are not applicable and all Constitution applies everywhere where there's American land. So that's the concern. That's a reality for the people of American Samoa. That's why we believe that this resolution should be reconsidered.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. And with respect to the culture, I'm from Utah, and there is nothing that we appreciate more than our close relationship with American Samoa. So thank you. I yield back.
Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Moore, thank you. Ms. Talib, you have 5 minutes, and if you're not going to use up your time, you can yield it to me. Feel free.
Well, Mr. Chair, I'll make sure to leave you some time if you'd like. thank you so much for this opportunity. I appreciate it. I know, and you know, we have in our country, we are a country that likes to believe we have moved away and beyond from, or moved beyond separate but equal. But in reality, we're closer to the Plessy versus Ferguson's famous racism than we would like to admit. So from students in my hometown in Detroit Public School students being denied an education capable of teaching them to read. They actually filed, Mr. Chairman, a right to literacy case, to the number of residents in our U.S. territories having their constitutional rights curtailed. We still have so much work to do to make good on the promise of freedom and justice for all. So I want to focus my remarks today on the legacy of the insular cases and how they work today to deny residents of the U.S. territories access to life-saving federal programs. And as everyone knows, I really try to put a human face to the impact of what is actually happening. So we're all familiar with the Medicaid program and that it's a critical lifeline for many low-income people seeking health care. And it's critical for them to survive and thrive and so much more. But it's so outrageous, Mr. Chair, that Medicaid funding to U.S. territories is subject to an arbitrary cap that prevents responding to changing economic conditions or emergency situations like the pandemic. So residents in the Michigan 13th have access to SSI that helps them keep a roof over their heads and food on their tables. Yet residents, our neighbors in the U.S. territories, are unfairly excluded from receiving the same benefits. Food insecurity especially is bad during this pandemic, and the economic downturns our communities have felt has been tremendous, but yet SNAP and TANF are only available in certain communities and territories, and their funding, again, is arbitrarily limited. So Congress, I believe, has a duty to the 3.5 million people of the U.S. territories to undo the separate and unequal status quo to deliver life-saving relief. So, Mr. Rear, can you talk about the human impact in Guam and elsewhere in the U.S. territories for being denied the same social service benefits that people in my district have access to?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, if I may, I'd like to extend a thank you to the Congresswoman. I couldn't have agreed with you even more, and I truly appreciate your comments. And I believe that with the Congress having the plenary powers, I think that this is something that we could do and work together to have uplift all the territories and work with the federal programs and make it have that parity with all the territories as it relates to the federal programs. And that
Thank
is something
so-
that can truly lift, uplift our communities.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you so much, Vice Speaker. And Mr. Rear, you know, can you talk a little bit more in detail about, again, the direct impact on some of the caps and the arbitrary kind of process of how we prepare? But I do appreciate your comments, Vice Chair.
Well said by the Vice Speaker. And yes, these are life and death choices that residents of the territories have no political voice in deciding. That's the arbitrary, undemocratic, and colonial nature of the Insular cases. And you know, this is one of the cases that the vice speaker had mentioned earlier in her testimony, Schaller versus the Social Security Administration. You have a situation where a woman facing severe health challenges because of a genetic condition. Her and her twin sister have faced this condition, received SSI benefits in Pennsylvania. But when she moved home to Guam to be cared for by her family members, she was denied those benefits, while her twin sister, who had the same identical genetic condition, continued to receive them in Pennsylvania. This is a challenge that has been brought in the Guam District Court, ruled unconstitutional by Judge Tidinko Gatewood. It's going to be one of several cases that are going to be in play as the Supreme Court considers this Bayo Madero case. Mr. Bayo Madero is a gentleman who the United States government came after they gave him SSI benefits when he moved from New York to Puerto Rico. Here's a person who's getting the benefits because he's indigent, and the federal government prosecutors come after him for $20,000 that he doesn't have.
Yeah.
It's before Hurricane Maria. And again, you know, the federal government has lost in the lower courts. Now it's before the Supreme Court. So this is really, as you identified, these are real people's lives. And this is something that, these are benefits that Americans and other communities just take for granted.
Yeah, no, thank you, Mr. Reary. And I know my time is up, but for all my colleagues, as we continue our movements for justice for all in our own country here, we must include our brothers and sisters in the U.S. territories and make their fights our own as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. As a chair, I need to get some more clarity onto the hearing record one of the witnesses alluded that the Wong Kim Ah case was decided on a racist case. Professor Villajoy, would you like to explain? Because my understanding is the U.S. v. Wong Kim Ah was a landmark decision of the U.S. Supreme Court, which held that a child born in the United States of parents of Chinese descent who at the time of this birth are subjects of the Emperor of China, but have a permanent domiciliary and residence of the United States. Can you please explain in more detail the Wong Kim Ah? So just so the hearing record reflects that.
Yes, thank you, Congressman. Wong Kim Ah is indeed a landmark decision by the Supreme Court. In interpreting the 14th Amendment, the Supreme Court held that anyone who is born in the United States is a U.S. citizen subject to the jurisdiction thereof under the 14th Amendment Citizenship Clause. So I'm a bit surprised, actually, that Wong Kim Ah has been described here as a racist case. Far from that, I argue, because it was at this time that the Chinese Exclusion Act was operating to exclude Chinese from our U.S. borders. And so Wong Kim Ah is an important opinion with respect to strengthening what the Citizenship Clause means.
Thank you. Mr. Dr. Watson, I think. I know Dr. Imawar. Yeah, Dr. Imawar. I got it.
Thank you so much, Imawar. Yes, I think it's important to distinguish a ruling made by racists from a racist ruling. The argument that we're making here is that the Insular cases are not only rulings made by racists who reason racially as they do so, but that the ruling itself has a racially discriminatory outcome. Wong Kim Ah goes the other way. If the suggestion is just that any ruling made by anyone who had discriminatory racial views should be overturned, you know, that would be the entire 19th century right there. What we're pointing out here is that the Insular cases are decided by a racist ruling that is relevant, and the racism of the judges is sort of core, not incidental to the ruling.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much. I see having no other Ms. Blaskett. Is Ms. Blaskett on?
Mr. Chairman?
All right.
Mr. Chairman, if I may? Vice Speaker Chinwendu Barnes-Bloom.
Oh, well.
If I could just add a tiny note.
Make it short, please.
Yes. You know, I truly believe that Congress does not have to wait. This is the opportunity for this committee to post sweeping legislation to address these inequities in the territories, protect our individual cultures, and pursue self-determination. And I truly appreciate what's happening today, because this is the time where we can take this opportunity to move forward. Thank you for that input, Mr. Chair.
Yeah, well, self-determination, I guess, would be an entirely separate issue from today's hearing. But anyway, I want to thank the witnesses for their valuable testimony. This is a really good hearing. And the members for their questions. The members of the committee may have some additional questions for the witnesses, and we will ask you to please respond to this in writing. Under committee rule 3, all members of the committee must submit witness questions within 3 business days following the hearing, and the hearing record will be held open for 10 business days for these responses. If there's no further business.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes,
Mr. Chairman, I just wanna introduce to the record the book of the facto incorporated U.S. territory of Puerto Rico of Mr. Gregorio Gartua. We will send it to the committee. And the book of the Chief Judge of Puerto Rico, Gustavo Golpi, the constitutional evolution of Puerto Rico and the other U.S. territories. That I think it's important lecture for this committee. And I will submit also for the record other further questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Now, objection, you have up to 5 o'clock today, I think, for the end of this hearing with whichever first occurs. But without objection, the committee stands adjourned. Thank you.